Savory. There's something for everyone tonight as we serve up a sensational selection of sugar and spice. Let's meet some real sweeties. Sweet as a nut, it's Rose Matafeo. Come on. Sweet as pie, it's Alice Levine. Short and sweet, it's Jason Manford. Bet your sweet ass, it's Alan Davis. Let's see if their buzzers are sweet or spicy. Rose goes. Alice goes. Sweet dreams are made of things. Jason goes. Sweet Caroline. Bye bye bye. I just want to carry on. And Alan goes. Oh, wow. You all did a dancey thing. I once did a show with. Is she called Mel B? I did a show with her.
It depends who you're talking about.
Yeah.
Anyway, it was charming. What's sticky and well worth stealing?
A friggin' nice stick. I don't.
Wow!
But like a good stick, like the best stick you've ever seen.
Okay, you said stick. I thought you said something else entirely.
Well, wow. You're not gonna avoid. Stick.
Stick.
A stick.
Sorry.
Stick?
Yeah.
Wait, hang on. Yeah. I'm having an identity crisis.
No, it's fine.
No, you said stick.
Friggin' nice.
Did you say stick?
I agree that when my son, if we go for a walk, he finds the best sticks, and he will hold on to that stick to a point. My wife won't let them in the house, these sticks, because they've been outside. So he will leave it on the doorstep, and the next morning, when his stick is still there, it's like the PlayStation 5 has been delivered. It's like a box to a kitten, a stick to a kid.
Wait till you get him a toy.
I know.
Ah, there's a bloody forest out there. Help yourself, mate. It's like Toys R Us.
It's a weapon. It's a friend. Yeah. It's a companion.
Right. Exactly.
I love
Rose knows.
Like a stick.
She knows.
OK.
Yeah.
I've forgotten what the question was. So sticky and worth stealing.
Jam.
Sort of. It's kind
I'm going to say Post-its, because you don't ever buy that kind of thing, do you? You just steal that from
just
work.
From the 100%. Office.
Oh, yeah, that's good.
That's the problem with the work I do. I never go to an office. Stationery stealing.
It'd be a good idea.
What's that?
For a website where you could buy some stuff, but there was a shoplifty corner.
That's such a good idea.
And if you avoided being detected by a couple of windows and you could get into the shoplifting room, you could nick a couple of things and get away with
it. That's such... Let me write this down. I'm so sorry.
Because the fun of nicking something is gone at the moment, isn't
it? Have you shoplifted?
No one's nicked anything for ages.
I've never shoplifted in my entire life, though. Have you shoplifted?
Oh, God.
Oh, yeah.
Really?
Oh, yeah. I haven't.
Are
as
you
a schoolboy, it was an absolute rite of passage.
Oh, my God.
I remember I had friends who had an aquarium and they'd go in the pet shop and just get weeds out of the fish tank.
I stole a Kinder Egg when I was about 13. I felt so guilty that I actually took it back the next day and put it back on the...
Alice, have you shoplifted?
They should...
I think you know the answer to this. I'm such a goody two-shoes. I haven't.
So the three women have not shoplifted. I'm just putting it out there.
Rose has committed many crimes.
I've committed fraud. I've been to jail for fraud. But that's a clever one.
Were you the person at school who got other people to nick stuff for you?
100%. We had people real racket.
Go in there and get me something. Yeah. Or if you don't, I'm going to beat the
Rose
crap out of you.
Rose went straight for Ponzi scheme. $200 billion Ponzi.
100%. OK, so we are going for something sticky, but it's something you could put on pancakes.
Oh,
syrup. Maple syrup.
Maple syrup. So, over several months, from 2011 to 2012, there was a group of thieves and they stole 3,000 tonnes of maple syrup from Canada's global syrup reserves. Aren't we? Who's not glad that those exist, right?
Oh my God.
It became known, and I love this title, The Great Maple Syrup Heist.
Oh, good.
I know.
Good name.
Does what it says on the tin.
What should we call it?
Yeah.
No, I feel like there have been other heists, but they just stole a sachet or something. No, so
when does it become a heist?
When it's enormously valuable. This is the most valuable heist in the whole of Canadian history. So Canada produces 80% of the world's maple syrup. 90% of that comes from Quebec alone, and they have a strategic reserve of about 160,000 or more barrels, which are worth $1,800 each. Okay, wow. It's quite a lot of money.
Ooh.
And this is controlled by a group called the Federation of Quebec Maple Syrup Producers, the FPAQ.
Great bunch of lads.
I know, there. Such fun at parties.
They sound like a lot.
And they keep control of the supply. And the reserve is only checked once a year, so the thieves went into the place. And what they did was they systematically removed some barrels, temporarily replaced them with empty ones, siphoned out the syrup, refilled them with water and replaced them. Perfect crime, OK?
Yeah.
Because nobody knew. Uh-huh. Until a syrup inspector... I mean, the job of dreams, I think.
Wow, isn't it?
A syrup inspector went and had a look, climbed on a stack of barrels and nearly fell because of the empty ones weren't strong enough to take his weight.
Oh.
And he raised the alarm, and in total, 9,000 or more barrels had been emptied of maple syrup, worth $18 million.
Ring the alarm bell.
When is Guy Ritchie going to make that film?
I know.
I want to see Jason Statham doing a Canadian accent.
Yeah.
Floating in a tank of syrup.
It's thought, apart from the money, that the crime was motivated partly by bad feelings towards the FPAQ, the people in control. Yes.
And low blood sugar, probably, because have you ever been hungry?
Yeah.
When I've got food mood, I just have to eat there and then.
Like most of these crimes, there came a point where they should have just stopped.
Yeah.
If we steal any more syrup, someone's going to notice. They're going to know when they climb on the barrels. Let's stop at 1,000 barrels. What are we like? No. Are we greedy people? Yeah.
Mm. What a quote. With most crimes, there's a point where you should stop.
Just...
Yeah.
Where does maple syrup come from?
Maple tree?
It's called the sugar maple.
Ah.
And Quebec is currently the world leader.
Isn't nature amazing? Look at that. They've got... Look at the grow with a bucket on the side.
They're milking trees.
It's like they want you to have it.
Do you not think he looks like he's in a...
I don't know what he thinks he looks like. He thinks he's in a catalogue.
Yeah. Man from CNA.
I do suddenly want to buy some overalls for some reason.
Dungarees is the way forward. It is actually very interesting. I've been when they tap the sap. It usually starts running in about March because the warmer temperature makes pressure inside the tree increase, so the sap, which is basically just sugar and water, is squeezed, how can I put this nicely, out of any open orifice. Mm. And it takes 40 gallons of the sap to make 1 gallon of syrup.
Oh, my God.
So it's a lot. But it's not a European invention. It was made in the Americas long before the Europeans turned up, usually by women from the what we call the First Nation tribes who tapped the sap and then they collected firewood and boiled the sap to make spirit.
Sounds like a Danny Dyer game show. Tap the sap!
Ladies and gentlemen, let's tap the sap!
Tap the sap! Come on!
Here comes a bucket!
He doesn't know the rules of it.
In his ear. Shout, tap the sap, Danny. In which direction? Any way you like. We've got you covered.
Maple tapping not limited to humans. So squirrels have been seen systematically biting...
Stuck to trees. What's happened?
Systematically.
They never know their limit.
Oh, my gosh, me nuts are stuck. Sorry, Sandy, I went
to
the
bathroom. No, I'm trying to think where to go from sticky nuts.
the bathroom.
Yeah. They systematically bite into maple trees to allow the sap to flow. But here is the really clever thing. They don't just lap it up there and then go, yay, I got the sap to flow. They leave it and return so that once the water is evaporated, there's a higher concentration of the sugary sap.
Clever.
Thanks, squirrels.
Isn't that great?
Clever.
Yeah, lovely.
Yeah, it's really... I thought, good on you.
Team players.
I know. Explain to me how adult licorice works.
All licorice is adult licorice because only adults like licorice.
Correct.
No. Yeah. Mm.
And I think sometimes mums pretend to like it just so there's something in the house that nobody else is going
to
eat.
OK, you've never been to Scandinavia. We just all love licorice.
Yeah, love licorice.
And we are going to try some, OK? The thing that makes it adult is that it is extremely salty. So the flavour comes from ammonium chloride, which the Finnish people called samyaki. OK? The Scandinavians say the stronger and saltier the better, and I absolutely agree. So you have a little bowl like this. Try it if you don't like licorice. Who likes licorice?
I like licorice.
I like licorice.
I don't know if I like salty licorice.
Licorice, adult licorice.
Oh, my God!
Huh? How good is that?
Boy, oh boy.
Oh,
God. Actually, turn around, Sandy.
There's no good.
Turn around.
Alan spat it out.
My spine feels weird. What's happening?
That is... Do you like that, Jason?
I think once you get over the initial shock,
disappointment.
Yeah, it just becomes disappointing.
It just becomes steadily more depressed.
Yeah, it's all right.
There are health implications.
Really? Thanks for telling us now.
I made the right call.
Too much ammonium chloride is bad for you, and so the European Union wanted to set the cap at 0.3%. But licorice is like 10 times that much, salty licorice. And there was a genuine fear that the people of Scandinavia, the Finns in particular, would leave the EU if they messed with their licorice.
Oh, God.
You know, a Sammy exit.
Yeah.
So an exemption was made for sweets and ice cream. It just has to say adult licorice, not licorice for children, on it.
Do you have to have an ID to get it?
I don't think you need to worry about children accidentally eating this.
No.
I mean...
No.
It's incredibly resistant to saliva.
Yeah.
That's a good quality in a man, I think.
Oh, my God.
Be a good thing to put in a purse, that.
Oh, my God.
Wanted, man, incredibly resistant to saliva.
Oh, God.
Able to tolerate adult licorice.
Are you not...
No other qualities necessary.
I hope this doesn't become a thing now. I don't want to start seeing...
Every time you come on QR, we give you a shit sweet.
Sweet and sour... Sweet and sour jelly babies.
Yeah.
I don't want to see this.
That's sort of like jerky, isn't it, really?
Oh, do you like... I like jerky. I think jerky is pretty lovely.
But not when you're expecting a sweet.
Yeah. It's like a Jaffa cake, but it's got chicken tikka masala.
But it has been so popular for so long that it was found in Tutankhamun's tomb.
In the tomb, Sandy.
Yeah, let's bear it. While he's going, while the lid's open, put the licorice in. It's incredibly resistant to saliva.
Yeah, get rid of them.
Ancient Romans used it for bladder problems, kidney stones, ulcers, all sorts of things.
Oh, it's medicine. Yeah, it tastes like medicine.
Tastes a bit like medicine. Yeah.
But, like, medicine, when it's... You know when you're a kid and medicine's actually quite nice? It's like strawberry and banana, and then about 13, they go, oh, you can have chalk now. You know what I mean? Like, that, it's that, such, that age of medicine.
The English physician Nicholas Culpepper, so we're talking 17th century, recommended taking it against coughs, growths in the eye and ulcers on the genitals.
I mean, it only tastes like it's been rubbed on someone's genitals, so...
What is the town in the UK that we link with licorice? There's one town in West Yorkshire.
Towns in West Yorkshire.
Pontefract.
Of course, somebody. Pontefract.
Pontefract cakes. Absolutely right. Mm. So it's extraordinary that it's in Pontefract because the plant is native to Southern Europe and Western Asia. Probably arrived in Pontefract in about the 16th century via Dominican monks. And by the 1920s, there were 10 licorice factories in the town.
But they're all sweet. Licorice.
They're the sort you
No-one's
like.
Coming like, lads, have I got an idea for you? Imagine it was this product that we've been selling millions of, but it tastes like shit. Imagine that. Imagine.
I love it. I'm just saying to you.
Not a single convert in the house, I know.
I know. Anyway, which head of state did the Spice Girls sleep with?
Well, I'm nervous to say this, but Nelson Mandela.
You think...
Yeah. It seemed too obvious.
I also sort of think we'd have heard about that.
Do you think?
You know, like, it feels like a big story.
Well, he said,
know?
Which is pretty shocking, that it was the best day of his life when he met the Spice Girls.
Was it?
Wow.
I mean, Nelson Mandela.
Wow. Did you?
When I was three. In New Zealand, he came to speak and all of the crowd, like, surged forward and I was sitting on a barrier and it kind of pushed me and I was next to my brother. And so I started crying and he came up to me and he was like, why are you crying? Why are you crying? And then I was like, my brother punched me to Nelson Mandela. And then he was like, oh, don't cry. And tried to comfort me. And then my mum was like, do you know who that person was? And I was like, no, I don't. I'm 3 years old, right?
Rosie has bigger fish to fry.
Yeah, exactly. So the best day wasn't that day that he met me. That's very upsetting. What were you saying? Sorry.
So we are slightly misleading you.
Mel B's child has obviously just farted.
Which one's Mel B, Sandy?
Yeah, come on, Sandy.
Point out the Mel B.
Yeah, you met her, didn't you?
Mel B's the one wearing a crocodile.
That's right.
Yeah. Right, so we're talking China. We're talking China, the Spice Girls of ancient China. So these were the concubines who slept with the emperor.
And what a job.
They're calling them Spice Girls because in the Han Dynasty China, so we're talking about 202 BC to 220 AD, the emperor's concubines would live in a pepper house. So basically, you've got mud and plaster on the walls, and it's mixed with Sichuan pepper. So the spice, it's really nice. It provides a sort of warm and fragrant atmosphere. And also the plant is a symbol of fertility because it has so many seeds. And even today, they throw it sometimes as confetti at newlyweds, sort of in rural areas of China.
Sichuan pepper?
Sichuan pepper, yes. It's basically the dried berries of the prickly ash tree. Anyway, you get the sensation, right? That it's not really spiciness. It's like a tingling, numbing sensation. So, we're going to try it, OK? So, having gone for the licorice, what I want you to do is to take one and to bite just one... No, not the whole thing, darling. You'll die.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well, why would you put all of them in there? Why would you risk that?
I wanted to give you a choice.
I was about to...
No.
Down here.
No, yes.
I was...
Oh, yeah. My God.
Last time we saw Jason Manford. So bite it and let it cover your tongue. May I advise you not to swallow it?
It's been the worst game I've ever played since the licorice game.
Yeah. So bite it and then let it cover your tongue and you should get a sensation which is called paresthesia. And are you all right, Jason? That's...
I think I've had a reaction.
No, it feels like at the moment, feels like, you know, sometimes you see something on the carpet and you think, oh, it's a bit of a nut or something, it's a bit of a crumb of food.
Yeah.
And you pick it up and put it in your mouth, but if it actually, that isn't food.
No.
That's come out of the dog's arse or off the kid's shoes.
Who let the rabbit in the house?
What do you think, Alice?
It is really citrusy.
Yeah. Mm. Is it nice?
It is
not unpleasant.
It's not unpleasant.
Almost got the tingle of something menthol-y.
Yes, and it gives you just this kind of... It's almost like a tiny little vibration.
It reminds me of the... There's a cafe near me that hasn't been decorated for 60 years. It reminds me of their loo. The surface of my tongue now feels like it wants to leave my body. Is that what happens?
It's really fizzy, isn't it?
It's like putting your wet tongue on a battery. Yeah. So they did a test to see how many vibrations is it actually causing, and what they did was they got 28 volunteers and they were kitted out with little tiny vibrating tools and they were asked to adjust it until it matched what they could feel on their tongue. And Sichuan peppercorns make lips vibrate at 50 hertz, which is the same as a cat's purr.
Really?
Are you eating them all now?
I've had them now. Finished.
Have you eaten the lot?
Yeah.
Are you swallowing them?
Who said that?
Your insides are going to be vibrating at 50 hertz.
Yeah.
When you do learn to fly? What's going on? Oh my God.
Just
tell you what, when you have a couple, woo! Now we're talking! Woo-hoo!
Wow, you
have a little line of blood coming out of one nostril.
Yeah. Are you currently experiencing the last third of 2001 Space Odyssey? You're just flying.
Oh, wow!
Zingy and sherbety.
Wow! Yeah!
Right.
Jason is struggling now. No!
Oh, it's 3:47 p.m. Jason has had a whole bowl of peppercorn.
Grandad?
It's 4 hours since Jason had the peppercorn.
I don't do drugs like, but that was the nearest.
Did you?
I've come to it.
Yeah.
I can actually see the back of my head.
Question: what did the original Peter Piper pick?
Pepper.
Pumpkin. Ooh. Oh!
Not pepper. What else?
Pumpkin.
Pumpkin. Do they have pumpkin in New Zealand? Is that?
Do they have pumpkin in New Zealand? Yes, but also weirdly, in New Zealand we eat pumpkin, and apparently here you guys feed them to pigs. You're from England, I assume. Do you eat pumpkin?
No.
Why not?
I've got too many pigs to feed.
So, our best guess is it was a real person called, behind the tongue twister, a one-armed French horticulturalist called Pierre Poivre. And it's a really interesting story. So we're talking 18th century. So he began his travels as a missionary. You all right?
Yeah, I'm fine, yeah.
Sweating.
I'm just thinking of all the mistakes I've made in my life.
You appear to be having the menopause.
I'm having everybody's menopause.
Yeah. Why did you give him a little bowl of ayahuasca?
Yeah.
Don't give me a full bowl of anything and then say, do not eat the full bowl. Oh, I will do that.
The future... Bring on the starboard.
So who's this guy now?
This guy. What's going on? Yeah, he wasn't interested in peppers at all.
He's the Pied Piper.
Well, he was involved in the spice trade, but he was interested in nutmeg and cinnamon and cloves and not peppers. So he started his career as a missionary in China. Mm-hmm. I don't know what happened. He was wrongfully arrested as soon as he arrived. Who knows?
Mm. Been there, buddy.
I know.
So he Rose, you know.
I like this. He taught himself Chinese to defend himself in court. And when the mission ended, he sailed back to France, but there was a skirmish with a British ship and he lost an arm to a cannonball.
You know. And we've all been there.
Worst holiday ever.
Had to rest up in Indonesia.
Wow.
And then he hatched a plan to smuggle spices because in the 18th century, it's sort of hard for us to believe, spices were the tradable commodity. Some of them were worth more than gold. Mm-hmm. And the Dutch had complete control over spice distribution. They went to extreme measures to make sure they had this monopoly. So, for example, they'd get nutmeg seeds and they'd douse them in lime before they exported them so that they wouldn't sprout, so that you couldn't grow your own. And smuggling seeds was a crime punishable by death. But he transported more than 3,000 plants into Mauritius and Seychelles and Réunion and began growing them. It's one of the reasons why we have spices that we can trade so easily today.
Nutmeg was used, wasn't it, to preserve meat on the ship?
Yeah. I mean, spices were really important.
And I know a little bit about this because I went to the island of Banda in Indonesia, which was exchanged for what is now the island of Manhattan in a property swap.
Is that David Jason?
That's him. That's Peter. That's Peter without either arm, frankly.
I've got loads of nutmeg. Come in.
Have you seen those videos of the cinnamon challenge? You know, when people have a teaspoon of cinnamon? Because you can't swallow
a teaspoon of cinnamon.
And I think it works with nutmeg as well. They are incredibly resistant
to
saliva.
But the arrogance...
the one thing about them, deeply resistant to saliva.
But you have to be careful with nutmeg because it contains a compound called myristicin and it can cause hallucinations.
It's profoundly untrustworthy.
It can cause hallucinations in high doses.
Really?
So it's a really, really bad idea.
Jason. Where's Jason? He's on a bad nutmeg trip. Yeah.
No, yeah. You can get all sorts of side effects. You can get anxiety and fear and sort of hostility and a feeling.
I think I might have been on nutmeg my whole life.
I did nutmeg. It was crazy.
So the nursery rhyme that we were talking about at the very beginning, darling, that was very first published in 1813 in Peter Piper's Practical Principles of Plain and Perfect Pronunciation. And it has a tongue twister for every single letter of the alphabet. So here is the one that we think is based on this character, Pierre Poivre. But this is the S series, so we've got the rhyme for S. Who wants to try?
Let's do it.
Do it. Jason, go for it.
Sammy Smelly smelt a smell of small coal. Did Sammy Smelly smell a smell of small coal? If Sammy Smelly smelt a smell of small coal, where's the smell of small coal Sammy Smelly smelt? Well,
I'm having the same sort of surge of rage that I used to have when one of my siblings would get praised for doing a simple task.
Yeah, yeah.
We also have...
I've been asked to do. What are you clapping that for? He's just read it.
All right, Billy Big Balls, you have a go.
Yeah, go on then.
Sammy Smelly smell a small coal. It's on the bloody screen.
All of it. I had to do all
of it. Sammy Smelly smell a small coal. Sammy Smelly smell a small coal. Where's the smell of small coal? Sammy Smelly smell.
Did you feel it faster?
And I don't want applause. It's reading.
Well done, okay.
No, that's terribly impressive.
Oh,
well done.
God.
Do you know what small coal is?
No, and care not.
Anybody?
I imagine it's tiny coal.
It is.
For a tiny fire in a tiny house.
It's what they used to call slack. It's coal about the size of hazelnuts. It's to start the fire. But I'm terribly impressed with your articulation. Peter Pepper nicked a nugget of nibbly nutmeg. What makes my ice cream taste...
Some of those words began with the same letter. It's 40 years in the business. 40 years to achieve this.
That's craft. That's stagecraft right there. That is stagecraft.
That took my breath away.
Extraordinary. Mm-hmm. The same letter at the beginning of the word.
Thank you, darling. It is 40 years. What makes my ice cream taste like shit?
Maybe it's your bad attitude, Sandy.
Maybe you're putting licorice in it. That looks tasty. Has that got cornflakes?
That looks actually quite good.
Mm. That does look
nice. It's in a toilet bowl, but I'll get over that.
Is it shit? Has someone put shit in the ice cream?
Well, so mammalian and bird feces get their smell from a high concentration of a molecule called scatol. Mm. So it's a thing that we all produce in our digestive tract, and the people who produce too much of it have terrible halitosis. Oh. Anyway, at very low concentrations, it has a sort of sweet floral aroma, like, orange blossom or jasmine or something. And so it's used in the ice cream industry as a flavour enhancer. can either smell great or it can smell terrible. It's also used in perfumes.
Yeah, but your own farts.
Yeah, it's used in perfumes and colognes as well, flavouring in cigarettes. The name is the Greek for dung. Anybody heard of something called castoreum? It's taken from the glands found near the rear ends of beavers.
Oh.
But it gives depth to vanilla and strawberry flavour.
Oh, sure.
Rear end of a beaver?
Yes, I know.
Isn't that the beaver?
The beaver's beaver.
The beaver's beaver?
Yeah.
You're thinking, this strawberry ice cream is lacking something.
A bit of beaver.
Give me a beaver.
Yeah. A bit of beaver's beaver.
Turn it around, turn it around. This is the bit I'm interested in. Now, this will be some interesting ice cream. It's got a bit of a beaver gland in it.
Hello, walls. Do I have the solution for you?
In Sweden, there is a drink, it's actually rare to find it these days, called bäverhöjt, and it's a liqueur flavoured with castoreum. Mm. It was traditionally drunk by beaver trappers. Again, a job I hadn't thought of. Ah, anybody? What's that approaching? Anybody? What is that?
Oh, Mum, can I have a pound?
What is it?
It's the ice cream van.
It's the ice cream van.
Sorry, no, I've got to say, that is the most terrifying soundscape of an ice cream
van. That's what it used to be. So in the UK, what would happen is, if you just got out of prison, you were allowed to be an ice cream man. It was the only way you were legally allowed near children.
Wow.
Yeah, that was how it used to work. And so they would have that music.
Yep.
It was actually supposed to be a warning, but weirdly, we all lined up and we waited to meet the weirdo giving us ice cream. Brilliant.
Do they not have ice cream vans in New Zealand?
No, they absolutely do, but not with that child catcher-esque sort of doomful, like...
Do you know what the tune is?
Green sleeves.
Yes. Yeah, so why do ice cream vans play green sleeves so much?
It's a banger.
Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah.
It's something to do with Henry VIII. It must be.
It is to do with
He Henry invented VIII. Ice cream.
No, ice cream was invented about 200 years after he
passed. Henry VIII never had ice cream.
No, he
probably knew that he hadn't had ice cream.
Yeah.
He'd be behead so cross. Someone.
Yeah,
he you mean I haven't had ice cream? What's it hasn't been off? Invented. Kill someone!
So we're going back to 1958, and there was a man called Dominic Facchino, and he'd been to the United States and seen ice cream trucks, and he thought it was marvellous, and so he decided to start his own venture. He started it in Birmingham. The Mr. Whippy ice cream van.
Oh!
Mr. Whippy, we got Mr. Whippy Mr. in New Whippy. Zealand,
yeah?
And he chose it because he was a huge fan of Henry VIII, and the king... was credited with composing the tune. He didn't. He didn't compose it at all.
I wrote that!
Yeah, that's not him.
Okay,
sir. Yeah, all right, sir, yes. Okay,
the real composer's in the tower. I've got an idea for a very, very cold, fruity dessert as well, in the tower.
Yeah, and another nod to Henry is Mr. Whippy's hat, which Facchino intended to be based on a Tudor hat. So if you look at...
Told you, straight out of prison.
Yeah.
My friend's mum used to tell her that when the music was playing, it meant they'd run out of ice cream.
That's a common ruse.
Yeah, but it works. It does. I mean, you wouldn't bother, would you, running down the street after it?
It means I haven't got any.
When I was a kid, well, there was two ice cream vans. There was Mr. Whippy and there was Meskies. And my dad, who was a staunch sort of socialist, verging on communist, to be fair, said we weren't allowed Mr. Whippies because Margaret Thatcher was part of the scientific team who created
Mr. Whippy
ice cream, and he disliked her so much we weren't allowed Mr. Whippy ice cream.
They always have like bootleg cartoons painted on them, don't they?
Yes.
Ice cream vans.
Yeah.
And you think if Disney just chased them down, they wouldn't really need to make any other money if you were just like that dodgy looking goofy on the back of there. No, we'd make millions from suing you, we're getting it.
So the question is, why don't ice cream trucks update their soundtrack? Why do they not have like a Spotify playlist or something?
Copyright, innit? You don't want Ed Sheeran suing Mr. Whippy. We love them both.
Green sleeves is surely out of copyright.
One of the reasons. One of the reasons is that it's cheaper. The older tunes are
unmistakably an ice cream.
That's the other thing, darling, is that people know what's coming. It's not just some car with their window down playing loud music.
Beginning of lockdown, I read that Greg's the Baker were going to do home deliveries, and when I got excited because I love a pasty from there, but I slowly realised that what they meant was like on one of these apps, like the delivery app, not... I thought it was like a Greg's van, like an ice cream van. And it was just... And you would just be like sat in your living room and then you would hear the Greg's van music playing. And you'd run to your wife, can I have a pound of Greg's van's here? And she'd be like, I've got pasties in the freezer. You're like, you're not the same. But unfortunately, that's
You've
not
got
business.
Pasties that in the freezer?
Yeah, they sell them at Iceland. Look, I'm not going to keep plugging these things.
feel so sorry for your children. Come in from a long day of playing with sticks and they still have an ice cream. No, you can lick a frozen pasty like your dad. If your ice cream smells like shit, someone's overdone the scuttle. What kind of person gives away their starters?
I sometimes have a starter for pudding.
I'll have an avocado prawn to finish.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, love it.
Really? Starters used to be terrible in Britain. I don't know about in New Zealand, but they used to be terrible in Britain. Yeah. Used to get it, especially like the orange juice.
The fruit juice.
The fruit juice.
What do you mean?
Yeah, and it would come on a little thing.
It would be the only time in the year that you would get squeezed orange juice.
Yeah. I'd feel really swizzed at that.
Yeah. Mm. Or you get half a boiled egg with some salad cream. That's a very nice starter.
Oh, yeah, that's a nice one.
Oh, where they've taken it out and put it back in again.
No, not even bothered with that.
Fine.
Literally just half a boiled egg. No, I'm not talking about the starter course of a meal. So, what other types of starter?
Oh, well, then you misled us, didn't you, Sam? That
is literally my job.
I can't keep giving you second chances.
Is it like a sourdough?
It is exactly right.
You can get a lot of that in lockdown.
Jason is there, absolutely right. So, sourdough gets its sour flavour from a lactobacillus bacteria. So, that's introduced to the bread via... it's called a starter. It's basically a mix of flour and water, which is left for a number of days until wild yeast and microbes from the environment have grown.
People like pass them through the families.
Well, this is the thing, darling. People pass them on and are slightly obsessed with
I'm that person.
Are you? Have you got a starter?
I do have a starter and I did give it away in the first lockdown. It's a lot of work.
It's the same with SCOBYs, with kombucha, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
And people become really obsessed with it. In fact, you can tell whose starter it is because you get particular bacteria on everybody's hands, right? So you can usually match a starter to the baker if you were able to test the bacteria on the hands and the bacteria.
I'm riddled.
You're riddled with the stuff. So theoretically, you can keep the starter alive forever and you just keep feeding it flour and water and pass it down from generations. So it's possible that bakers could be using the same starter that their great-grandparents
I'd love
used.
To be at that will reading where it's like someone gets a house and gets a car. I got a what?
But you know what's even even odder, I think, is that people name their sourdough starters. So there's a series of names. Jane Doe, Joan of Starch, Fred Farter the Bread Starter, John McIndoe and Clint Yeastwood.
Yes.
Great one. Love that.
Yeah. So, what is stressful for a sourdough enthusiast about holidays?
Well, you wouldn't be able to take it with you, would you? You wouldn't be able to take it on holiday.
You have to fridge it, which is quite stressful.
Ooh,
no,
can't.
See.
No,
so what if it starves? Well, you look like you could care about sourdough people.
Imagine you came home and your sourdough was dead.
If you put it in the fridge, it goes to sleep for a bit, but the chances of it coming back as it was, you know, will it have the same memories? Will it be as fun?
No. So there are now sourdough hotels.
Oh my God.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Good.
Finally.
Thank you.
There's a man called Martin Mayer who runs the Vuyat Bakery in Zurich, and he started his sourdough hotel because he went on holiday to South Africa and he took it with him, his starter, right? And he was going to worry about it in the heat in the car all the time. And so he developed a hotel and each starter is put in its own compartment and the staff are told how the person wants their starter treated. And apparently owners come and say goodbye and are visibly thrilled when they are reunited.
Wow.
It's 49 francs a week if you want to put your sourdough.
That's not bad.
Did you not take to baking, darling, in the lockdown? It didn't happen.
No. What is happening here?
I just ask you simple questions, Alan. You've eaten sourdough, you know nothing about
the 706 people in Britain who make their own bread, four of them are in this room.
People take it so seriously. So there's a man called, he's a Belgian baker called Carl de Schmet, and he's a sourdough librarian. This is his sourdough library.
No, he's not.
Yes.
That's not a job.
It is a thing.
Sorry. If you go to the job centre and go, what have you been up to? Go, I'm a sourdough librarian. Anything coming up?
He travels the world collecting interesting sourdough starters.
Wow.
He's currently got 125 in his library. Anyway, this is a very sad thing. I just need you to feel bad for Carl de Schmet. He's since developed an allergy to flour.
Wow.
Oh, Carl.
Do you know what the difference is between ordinary bread and sourdough?
Taste? Price?
No, it's the yeast. So most bread uses a single species of commercial yeast. Sourdough, it takes it from the air, from the baker's hands, from the environment and so on. But it is the oldest form of leavened bread, sourdough. I mean, there's astonishing stuff. If you went to Thebes, if you went to some of the ancient Egyptian sites, you can actually find 3,500-year-old bread. And what is amazing about it is you can see the handprint of the baker in either side of the bread.
3,000 years old?
3,500 really? Years ago,
That's
yeah.
the kind of bread that my mum would just go, no, that's it's fine. It's fine. Just scrape it off.
Cut the
scrape
green bit
it off.
And with that, we stumble into the sweet and sour swamp of general ignorance. Fingers on buzzers, please. Where does the UK get most of its sugar from? Ooh. Yes.
Morrison's?
Morrison's.
Good answer.
That's a very good answer, yeah. Any... But you want to name any other places? No?
What's the country?
No. OK. What is a country...
Just generally, is it?
In a country... comes from a country? Does it come from a country?
A country other than the UK?
Yes.
No.
What?
Yes. So...
Ah! Yeah. I thought that was foolproof.
No, you went wide and were wrong. No, over 50% is supplied by the British beet sugar industry. And the rest is from the EU. And then there is a bit of cane sugar imported, but the majority is grown in the UK. On the topic of Britain and sugar, do you think we're eating more or less than we used to?
I think we're probably eating less.
Yeah, it sort of depends on what you say, what we were used to. So there was a significant increase in sugar intake starting around the 1950s. And it reached 47.3 kilos per capita in 1961, but it has been declining. Today, it's about 35.2 kilos of sugar per person. But the sweeteners, anybody use sweeteners?
No.
OK, saccharin is the first artificial sweetener, roughly 300 times sweeter than table sugar. And Splendor, which is sucralose, 600 times sweeter. There's a new one called Neotame, 10,000 times sweeter than sugar.
My nan loves a sucral in a tea.
Really?
Yeah, my gran has a couple of... She's 97, and she has, I think she has something like two or three sweeteners. And she's 97.
Yes.
Don't matter, does it? She's already living on borrowed time.
I know.
She can have whatever she wants.
Yeah.
She can start crack tomorrow if she wants to. 97.
Yeah.
But I fancy a bit of crack, actually.
Yeah. Like, help yourself.
Fine, 97, knock yourself out.
Most British sugar is homegrown. What did William Wrigley Jr. start a company for?
It's chewing gum?
Oh, I was totally going to say that. I'm so glad.
Alan.
A chewing gum was a kind of accidental byproduct or something, wasn't it, that they were trying to make?
Well, chewing gum has been around for thousands of years because people chewed on birch sap and all kinds of bits. He actually started a company selling soap in 1891, but he believed, he had a philosophy, everybody likes something extra for nothing. So he started offering baking powder as a promotional item, and that was such a success, he just went straight to baking powder, and then chewing gum became his freebie. And soon, the chewing gum was more popular than anything else, and by 1892, he was just selling chewing gum, and these favourites, Juicy Fruit and Spearmint there, 1893, they had become the absolute favourites that they, I think, still are.
That's incredible that the branding is pretty much
hasn't really changed, has it? Not really. By 1909, Wrigley Spearmint was the best-selling gum in the US. And he did this brilliant thing. He collected all the addresses from American phone books and sent a packet to every single home, and then everybody knew about Wrigley's, and the rest is history. But to talk about people chewing gum forever, in 2019, scientists at the University of Copenhagen... they managed... This is astonishing. They managed to sequence a complete genome of a human being based on the saliva from a discarded piece of chewing gum, which was... 5,000 years old. Wow. It came from the island of Lolland. Lolland is just south of Copenhagen. And so they named this girl who had eaten this piece of chewing gum, Lola. They called her after Lolland. And they deduced from this one piece of gum that she was lactose intolerant, she suffered from gum disease, she had blue eyes, dark skin, dark hair, and had recently eaten a meal of duck with hazelnuts from that one piece of gum.
Wow.
Do you not think that's a...
And she wasn't brought up right if she stuck that under a bus seat.
It was not right.
That's amazing.
But I just think that's incredible.
That is, that's so cool.
That's phenomenal, wow.
It's very cool. Anyway, this is an artist's impression of what we know about her. Can you name any South American countries due south of Mexico?
Brazil? It's going to be none of them, is it? Argentina!
What is it? There aren't any?
Chile! I could do this all day!
Well, it feels like there can't be any, then.
There aren't.
It must be twisted around.
Yeah, so when you look at the map, the whole of the South American mainland is east of Mexico. Indeed, 99% of it is east of Florida. The only exception is Easter Island, which does politically belong to Chile. So you could have said Chile and we wouldn't have...
I did actually say Chile.
Did you say Chile?
Yeah, so scrub that.
Yeah.
I was right.
Sorry. one way to remember that South America sticks out like that is to sort of imagine it on its side and then the Americas look uncannily like a duck. If we can swivel that around like
that.
Oh,
wow.
That's very cool, isn't
yeah.
it?
I mean, it helps that you've coloured it in.
Yeah, I think that's true.
Yeah, a lot of things can look like a duck when you're coloured
them. You may think it's quackers, but all of South America is east of Mexico. OK, imagine you work for British intelligence. Who can you tell?
Well, anybody, but then you have to kill them.
What?
Wow.
Are you in my head now?
No, it's not the answer. Anybody else?
Your mum?
You could tell your mum. Yes, you could tell your mum.
Oh.
How many people do you think you could tell?
Two people.
It's not actually a number, darling. So it's the people that you feel it's essential for you to tell in order for you to be able to carry on with.
So you just start seeing a guy like for 2 months, and you're like, I just want to tell her.
Yes,
and then
you get assigned an agent handler to discuss the pros and cons of making an informed decision as to whether or not you should tell.
Really?
Yeah. So they'll check it out. The general advice is to tell close family members or friends.
Okay.
There was an MI6 employee who was invited by the BBC to be interviewed and he told them that the interviewer was the sixth person he had told.
I mean, I'm not saying it's the same thing, but I didn't tell anybody I was on The Masked Singer. So, you know, it's pretty good, isn't it?
What were you on it?
I was an hedgehog. You're the sixth person I've told.
And now she has to die.
I didn't even tell my daughter. And on the night of the final, when it was happening, she was watching it at her friends, and all her friends were going, "That's your daddy." And she was going, "I think I would know if my dad was on a TV show." And she came off, she was livid.
Was it stressful not to tell anyone?
No, it's great fun. The only time it backfired was I was on the phone to Alfie Bowe, who's you know brilliant opera singer, a good friend of mine. And I said, "Oh, you've been watching this Masked Singer?" And he went, he said, "Yeah, every Saturday night you get loads of tweets off people saying, 'Are you the hedgehog?'" So I thought, I'll watch it, see what everyone's going on about. And I watched this hedgehog singing and I thought to myself, I'm not that shit at singing, am I?
Oh,
and I was on the phone to him. I was like, yeah, well, maybe the costume's really heavy or something.
That's very good. There's a marvellous story about Rupert Murdoch. So he was furious. He was told that the former News of the World editor, Rebecca Brooks, couldn't take a call because she'd gone to the furniture store, which is called MFI, and apparently her PA had misheard her and she'd gone to an MI5 meeting. I think if you work for MFI, you shouldn't tell anybody. Speaking of concealing your intelligence, it must be time for the scores. In last place, as useful as a chocolate teapot, with minus 28, it's Alice! Scoring some brownie points in third with minus 24, it's Alan! Super sugar daddy in second with minus 20, it's Jason!
I'll take that. Second will do me. Wow.
And one smart cookie in first place with minus 19, it's Rose!
Yay. How did that happen?
Tonight, my thanks to Alice, Jason, Rose and Alan. I leave you with this savoury sign-off. If it looks like a duck, walks like a duck, talks like a duck, probably needs a little bit more time in the oven. Good night.